Dear participants, I now have the privilege of introducing to you one of the most important talks that we have been waiting for in this webinar. A chartered accountant by profession, a writer of political and social satires and commentaries by choice, the editor of the Thughlaq, a Tamil weekly news magazine by destiny. This is how the speaker of today, Sri Swaminathan Gurumurthy, introduces himself in his Twitter handle. Sri Gurumurthy needs no introduction to the Indian intelligentsia. However, there are many hats that he dons, and for the benefit of this audience, allow me the freedom for a quick and a brief introduction. Is he an economist? Yes, he is. And precisely why, he is the director of the RBI, the Reserve Bank of India. Is he into finance? Yes, he is a practicing chartered accountant. Is he a professional journalist? Yes. Who has done very interesting investigative journalism reports for the nation? Is he into politics? No, not electoral politics, because of the benign advice of a spiritual master, the Paramacharya of Kanchi. Could he have been in politics? Very well, yes. With 300,000 followers on Twitter, with India Today in its 2017 list mentioning him as the 30th of the 50 strong influential people in India, he could have easily made it into politics. But there is a very interesting story when we talk about his political connect. The 2014 elections in India, we know, did much to change the course of Indian history itself. And there was an amusing interplay with his namesake. And I am particularly pointing out this because the Hindu came out with an article whose title largely interested me. It said, "Baffled by the unexpected spotlight." And today, I want to rephrase what the Hindu said then and call Mr. Gurumurthy, our plenary speaker, unbaffled by the expected spotlight. Is he in the spiritual domain? Yes, an ardent follower of the Kanchi Paramacharya, one of the co-founders of the Vivekananda International Foundation. And what better way do I have to introduce his topic for today's talk than re-quote what Sri Gurumurthy said in his Independence Day tweet. I read, "Let us remember Vande Mataram of Bankim Chandra, Ramarajya of Gandhi, Hindu nationalism of Vivekananda, and the Sanatana Dharma of Aurobindo, which drove the freedom movement and millions of martyrs who gave from something to everything for us and got nothing for themselves. Steeped in such a rich spiritual and cultural tradition, it is but natural that Sri S. Gurumurthy has chosen to speak in this webinar on the topic spiritual nationalism according to Indian sages. My immense pleasure to invite Sri Gurumurthy sir to begin his talk.
With reverence and devotion to Swami, whom I have very blessed occasions to meet and be for hours, and with his benediction, I had shared my thoughts on the occasion of his Samadhi in Puttaparthi once. I will expound the concept of spiritual nationalism of Bharat.
The quantum education system which is West-centered and is founded in Western discourse, cannot understand non-Western civilization, their understanding about themselves, their worldview. So it is necessary for rising as a global power and for Indians to play their role at the global level to understand their own nation, their own evolution as a nation from an Indian perspective. The Indian perspective is lacking in Indian education system, Indian discourse, Indian media, Indian intellectualism. This doesn't need any great exposition or evidence. So in my view, an Indian perspective not only needs to be brought into the discourse, but has to be repeated, because we have to unlearn many things which we have learned and have made it virtually part of our synthetic DNA. So it is necessary that we talk about spiritual nationalism, which is the essential unifying factor of India. Spiritual means sacred. The most important thing about spiritualism is there is nothing called spiritualism unless there is sacredness. Spiritualism is the outcome of sacredness. So sacredness is the mother of human civilization. It should not be exclusive. An inclusive sacredness is what is spiritualism. You see, in ancient times, Bharat was known as Bharat Varsha. You know, many people have forgotten this because our discourse doesn't bring it out. And the idea of nation is in the Rig Veda. Actually, the word Rashtra is used in the Rig Veda to distinguish from the people. That is, people and Rashtra are aligned but still different. In Krishna Yajurveda, it goes a step further. There is a clear distinction between Janaha, Rajyam and Rashtram. And in fact, I am going to translate Krishna Yajurveda Brahmanam Aranyaka Anuvagam 183. It says the people should align themselves with the nation, Rashtra. If there is a conflict or non-alignment between the people and the nation, the interest of the nation prevails over that of the people. Because the collectivity of people, linking them to their forefathers, linking them to their past, to make them understand the present and to way to move forward, is nation. People are present. Nation links them to their past and roots them in the present and makes them look at the future. So that is the difference between nation and people. This is very clearly brought out in Krishna Yajurveda. You must understand this all in millennium common era. Now, you come to the Indus Valley to contemporary India. You know, Indus Valley was supposed to be pre-Vedic. Because the Saraswati River, which was mentioned in the Indus Valley, was supposed to be non-existent, is non-existent today. And so the Indus Valley civilization, which was a phenomenon which was based on Saraswati, and Saraswati being a mythic river, there is no difference, there is a wide divergence between Vedas, which spoke about Saraswati civilization, and Indus Valley. And so the Saraswati river was considered to be mythic. But Airavatam Mahadevan, who is one of the greatest exponents of Indus Valley civilization, in his final work identified that there is confluence between Vedic civilization and Indus Valley, and this has been endorsed by the finding, discovery of Saraswati through satellite imagery. They found that Saraswati river existed, and even now it is flowing underneath But because of tectonic shift, the Saraswati river got divided into two, and a part of it went into Yamuna and Ganga, and another part of it went into Indus, and that is how Saraswati as an explicit river disappeared, has been almost established by the satellite imagery. And Airavata Mahadevan's finding that there is confluence between Vedic verses and Indus Valley seal shows that there was confluence between the two. And this makes it clear that our civilization dates itself back to Indus Valley and continues even today. And D.D. Kosambi, who investigated the Indus Valley civilization and the Great Bath, related the Great Bath in Indus Valley to Kumbh Mela. And Kumbh Mela originated in Indus Valley is one of the most important findings of Kosambi. Both of them come to the conclusion that this Aryan invasion theory is completely false. The Aryan migration theory has lost its validity. And there is a link between Indus Valley civilization and us. And all the original work of the Western scholars that there was an Aryan Dravidian divide is very heavily questioned, is almost ruled out today. And I want to show how there is a continuity from Indus Valley civilization till today, and I am going to quote to you the Encyclopedia Britannica. While the Indus civilization may be regarded, words are important, the culmination of a long process indigenous to Indus Valley, very important, it is an autogenous indigenous growth. Number of parallels exist between Indus Valley and the rise of Mesopotamia, but the fact is Indus Valley is an indigenous growth. It is striking to compare Indus Valley with the better known and more fully documented region, and says, yet nearly all earlier writers have sensed the Indianness of the civilization, and even when they were largely unable to articulate it, the historian Golden Child wrote that India confronts Egyptian and Babylonia by the third millennium with a thoroughly individual, independent civilization of her own, technically the peer of the rest, and plainly it is deeply rooted in the Indian soil. The Indian Indus civilization represents a very perfect adjustment of human life to a specific environment, and it has ensured, and it is already specifically Indian and forms the basis of the modern Indian culture. This is very important because the entire scholarship promoted in the last 100 years is to cut off Indus civilization from India. And now, how Child goes on to establish and demolish this theory. The force of Child's words can be appreciated even without an examination of the Indus Valley script found on the seal. The attention paid to domestic bathroom, the drain, the Great Bath at Mohenjo-daro can all be compared to the elements in later Indian civilization, which is manifest in the Kumbh Mela. The bullock cart with the framed canopy called Ikkad. The boats are a little changed to this day. The absence of pins and love of bangles and the elaborate nose ornaments are peculiarly South Asian. The religion of the Indus is also replaced with suggestions straight known later in India. The significance of the bull, the tiger, the elephant, the composite animals, the seated yogi, god of the seals, the tree spirits, and the objects resembling Shiva, Shivalinga, all these are suggestive of the enduring form in the later Indian civilization. This is a very, very important perspective which is lacking in our education, that there is a continuity from Indus Valley days till today. Why it is important is that the division in our minds caused by the discourse that was promoted from outside to divide India, to make India a complex phenomenon, has made us feel that we have a disconnected past and we have no continuous past. And that is where I would like you to take you to the Puranas, where I don't think Puranas are taught in our curriculum. Puranas are dismissed as mythology, but Puranas describe the geography. Puranas describe the length and breadth of India. Puranas describe who are our neighbors on the west, on the east, and who are the people inside. This is not mythical, and this is continuous even today. And I would like to show, Agni Purana speaks about Rashtra as the most important element of the idea of state. So the state and Rashtra are different. The state and nation are different. There may be state which does not conform to the nation. We had 100 years, we had state which did not conform to the nation. The nation was different and the rulers were different. The rulers were conquerors, but the nation was different. So the nation as a concept was understood by the Puranas, and I am going to quote to you the several Puranas describe the geography of the world. The geography of the world is described in Indian Puranas, which is relevant even today. They say the world, the globe consists of 7 dvipas: Jambu, Laksha, Shalmali, Visha, Krauncha, Shaka and Pushkara. In each dvipa is divided into varshas. Jambu dvipa, where we reside, has 9 varshas. Bharata Varsha is the first and Sri Lanka is the last. This is how the geography is defined. This is not mythical. This is not imaginary. This is not imaginary. There is truth in the Purana, and these Puranas are not even according to the modern scholarship. The Puranas are 1500 years to 2000 years old. And in my view, they are older than this because they do not describe about Ashoka when they talk about Chakravarti. If Ashoka as a Chakravarti is not referred to in the Puranas, then these Puranas must predate Ashoka. That's a different thing. But all that I am saying is the Puranas are old enough, antiquate enough for India to realize that it has a past which is older, more antiquated than all the nations of the world put together except for China. So now Brahmanda Purana, which is dated by scholars to 7th to 10th century, it speaks about the continents of the world, and what it says about India, I tell you, that is the origin of what I will call as spiritual nationalism. This is a mysterious subcontinent in the middle of the universe where the fruits of karma are enjoyed, whether auspicious or inauspicious. This subcontinent is to the north of the ocean, to the south of Himalaya, is called Bharata, and its subjects are Bharatiyas. It is from here the Puranas claim that heaven and salvation are attained, and people go to the middle and ultimate end. Nowhere on this earth the Purana says that the holy rite has enjoined on the human being. Nowhere in the world holy rites of the kind are enjoined on the people like on the Indian people. There is an alignment between the culture, the people and the land. The land itself is sacred. That the land is sacred is accepted by all the scholars. And I don't want to dwell more into what the Puranas say. And these 18 Puranas describe Bharata Varsha as a sacred land. It is the Karma Bhumi. And all the people here ultimately have to look for moksha. This is the essence of spiritualism. Spiritualism is something which is lived on this earth for a higher purpose, which is meant for liberation. This is accepted by all, but this land is specifically chosen for that, and that is very important. And the person who in modern times, because 1000 years there has been a suspended animation in Indian history, there has been suspension of our culture, there has been disruption of our culture, and because of that, after 1000 years and more, Swami Vivekananda had to come and remind us, what is this nation? The nation in India must be a gathering up of scattered spiritual forces. A nation in India must be a union of those whose hearts beat to the same spiritual tune. This is Swami Vivekananda. This nation cannot be divided up or different from or distinguished from or separated from spiritualism. Spiritualism is the heartbeat of India. This is the proclamation of Swami Vivekananda. And he didn't do it only in regard to the nation. He related it to the territory. Formerly I thought, every Hindu thinks that this is the Karma Bhumi. Today I stand here and say, with the conviction of truth, that if there is any land on this world that can lay claim to be blessed Punya Bhumi, to be the land to which all the souls on this earth must come and account for karma, the land to which every soul wending its way to Godward must come to attain its lost home, the land where humanity has attained the highest towards gentleness, towards generosity, towards purity, towards calmness, above all, the land of introspection and spirituality, it is India. You know, all this we had, we still have the potentiality to realize all this. We have been mesmerized. Western scholarship to become different, to become part, to become independent, to become separate from the stream. We have to reconnect ourselves to the stream. And the most important thing is, when Swami Vivekananda spoke in the World Parliament of Religion, his quote is very important. I thank you in the name of the most ancient order of monks in the world. I thank you in the name of Mother of Religion. I thank you in the name of millions and millions of Hindu people of all class and caste. I am proud to belong to a religion which has taught the world both tolerance and universal acceptance. It is not that you merely tolerate another religion that is adequate. You have to accept the other religions as true for their followers. Whether you follow or don't follow a religion, don't deny the followers of religion have a legitimate right to believe that religion, and you must respect it. That is universal acceptance. You just tolerate a religion, it's an inferior religion, I tolerate it, will not produce peace between religions. This is what Swami Vivekananda says, both of tolerance and universal acceptance. This is the essential spirituality of Indian nationalism. Indian nationalism cultivated, sustained, promoted and kept alive this habit. Otherwise, there is no secularism in India. The very idea of secularism is rooted in spiritual nationalism, which Swami Vivekananda expounded in 1893 in the World Parliament of Religion. We believe not only universal toleration, but acceptance of all religions as true. I am proud to belong to a nation which has sheltered the persecuted refugees of all religions, of all nations on the earth. I am proud to tell you that we have gathered in our bosom the purest remnants of Israelites who came to southern India and took refuge with us in the very year in which their holy temple was shattered to pieces by the Roman tyranny. This is important. Article 29 and 30 of the Constitution was not there at that time. There was no minority protection. The minority protection in the Constitution and the Constitution itself is the product of this culture, this tradition, this spiritual foundation of India. It is not that India was born in 1947 or 1950. India reached a certain stage in its whole travel of trials and tribulations, ups and downs, defeats and victory, in the year 1949 to attain freedom in the contemporary world. And all that is expounded in the Constitution, which Pakistan could not, is because of the spiritual values kept alive in India. If spiritual values had not been kept alive in India, there would have been a mess. Then came Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi had to face a barrage of objections from the British. You are not one nation, you are not one people, you are all only people who migrated and invaded India, populated India. India does not have one character. You are not one nation at all. So Mahatma Gandhi wrote a monologue between himself as the editor and another reader, both are only himself. It is a monologue. It is an imaginary monologue. It was every Indian must read this book. It's a small booklet of 65 pages. Mahatma Gandhi wrote this when he was traveling from Cape Town to London. He wrote it in Gujarati. He He wrote on the right hand. When the right hand failed, he began writing by the left hand. He wrote as a possessed man. He wrote something from within. And it is an imaginary conversation between him and the reader. The reader propounding the what the objections of British and the British English educated people in India are about India, about Indian freedom. Whether India is worth its freedom. Is India a country at all? Is not British required to handle India? And I am telling you one of the questions which the reader addressed and how Mahatma Gandhi addressed it only on the basis that the Indian nationalism is spiritual. The reader asked the question. Only because of the railways and the post office, India became one nation. Otherwise, where is the question of India being one nation? So Mahatma Gandhi replied, I do not wish to suggest that we were one nation but had no differences. It is submitted our leading men travel throughout India, either on foot or on bullock cart. They learnt one another's language and there was no aloofness between them. What do you think could have been the intention of those far-seeing ancestors of ours who established the Setu Bandha, Rameshwar in the south, Jagannath in the east, Haridwar in the north as places of pilgrimage? You will admit they were no fools. They knew that worship of God could well have been performed just as well at home. They taught us that those whose hearts were aglow with the righteousness had Ganges in their home, but they saw India as one undivided land, so made by nature. So they therefore argued it must be one nation. Arguing thus, they established holy places in various parts of India and fired the people with an idea of nationality in a manner unknown in any parts of the world. And Mahatma Gandhi concluded so beautifully, and we Indians are one as no two Englishmen are. They are bound only by their racial consciousness and language. We are united by spirituality. This is Gandhi's conclusion. And the reader asked, Mr. Gandhi, you have described to me the pre-Mohammedan India. Now we have Mohammedan, Parsis and Christians. How can be one nation? Such a critical question which was asked then, which is being asked now, for which Mahatma Gandhi gave the answer. India cannot cease to be one nation because people belonging to different religions live in it. The introduction of foreigners does not necessarily destroy the nation, they merge in it. A country is a nation only when such condition obtains in it. The country must have the faculty of assimilation. Today, to utter this word assimilation is dangerous. You will be called majoritarian. You will be called imposing your views. No, there are certain values which are common between your forefathers and my forefathers, which we should inherit. Religion is different. That we should respect each other's religion is fundamental in India. That's why Swami Vivekananda said, he quoted this verse, Akasha Patitam Toyam Idagachati Sagaram Sarvadeva Namaskara Kesam Pradigachati. He said it in 1893 in the World Parliament of Religions and said, just as the raindrops collect into streams and rivers and go into ocean, all ways of worship lead to the same God. I don't think any other civilization could have conceived of a formula which is broader than this, more accurate than this, more modern than this to bring about unity among religions. And so he said that there are as many religions. In India, there are as many religions as there are individuals. There are Ishta Devatas, there are Grama Devatas. And we had 33 crore gods at one point of time. The number of gods were more than the number of Hindus. We had so many gods to be distributed. Anybody could choose any number of gods. We never fought over one god, as Swami Vivekananda said. Whether your God is superior or my God is superior, let us decide by a boxing match. Was not our way. We accepted all the gods. That it is only ways of worship which believes that there is one God that has created complications in the world, and we accepted all the gods, and that is the root of Indian spirituality. that's peculiar to this country, practiced in this country by the last man. So, this Mahatma Gandhi reminded, why it had to be done? Because the entire Western discourse started, most people do not know that the idea of nation state in the West evolved only in the 19th century. Erich Hobsbawm, who wrote Nations and Nationalism, 1780, in the year 1990, he wrote a book saying in the West there was no sense of nation state or nationalism till the 19th century. And their idea of nation and nation state was to have military power to conquer others. In that sense, we never had nationalism. We never had a nation state which would conquer others. We at best had a nation state which would defend us. And even then there were war rules that you cannot wage a war simply because you had an army. You have to conduct a yajna, Ashwamedha yajna. If others come and attend your yajna, they have accepted your leadership. And so you need not have to wage a war. Even if you wage a war, you have, if you win the war, you have to give the kingdom back to the defeated person. If he doesn't accept, you have to see whether there is, he has any heir. If there is no heir, you have to call the Mahasabha of the people and ask them to suggest the person to whom it can be handed over. You cannot appropriate the territory of another, culture of another, the treasury of another, and certainly not others. You know, this is called Dharma Vijaya. Lobha Vijaya is you acquire the territory and the treasure. And Asura Vijaya is where you take over the women and kill the men and all that. All the scholars of Indian warfare have declared that the third kind of war was never practiced in India. This is part of the idea of spirituality. Even in war, you don't have hatred. You know, this was not practiced in Mahabharata days. Padmanabha Menon, who wrote the History of Kerala book, he says in the 16th and 17th centuries, when there was war between the Zamori king and the Portuguese, the Zamori king writes a letter to the Portuguese that, you know, we have a war system where, you know, we don't wage the war where people are. We have it in a huge playground outside. There is pond there, there is common facilities. You can be in one place, you can be in another place. And we will beat the drum in the morning to say we are ready for war. And if you beat the drum only, we will attack. And if you beat the drum in the evening, we will stop the war. There will be no night war. The Portuguese asked, is the man asking for war or sports? You know, this has been, you know, a civilization needs to be judged at the worst time called war. They say in war there is no rule. In war we had rules. The most humanitarian rule, this is also product of the Indian spiritual nationalism. All this, Mahatma Gandhi had to fight. He had no education system, he had no schools, he had no leaders, he had no educated people to expose the view other than himself. Then came Maharishi Aurobindo. Maharishi Aurobindo, in his famous Uttarpara speech, captured what is India. What is the Indian spiritualism? It is almost around the same time. Mahatma Gandhi wrote this Hinswaraj book from which I quoted in the year 1909. And Aurobindo wrote this book around this, gave the speech around the same time and moved to Pondicherry in the year 1909, almost the same time. India is not a piece of earth. She is power. She is Godhead for all nations. Worship of Bharat worship. The worship of this land as sacred constitutes Indian spiritual nationalism. It is not in one God. It is not in one book. It is not in one spiritual leader. In fact, all spiritual leaders germinated out of this sacred land. So, Aurobindo said, when I say India shall rise, it means Sanatana Dharma shall rise. When I say India shall be great, it is Sanatana Dharma that will be great. When it is said that India shall expand and extend itself, it is Sanatana Dharma that will expand and extend itself. It is for Dharma and by Dharma that India exists. The word is not finished. If it is Sanatana Dharma which is for us nationalism, this is spiritual nationalism, at the highest. The Hindu nation was born with Sanatana Dharma. With it, it moves. With it, it grows. When Sanatana Dharma declines, this nation declines. If Sanatana Dharma were capable of perishing, and with Sanatana Dharma, it would perish. Sanatana Dharma is the nationalism. This is the message I have to deliver it to you today. This was his speech in Uttarpara. Whether it is Vivekananda, whether it is Mahatma Gandhi, whether it is Aurobindo. And now we may think Jawaharlal Nehru had a different idea. Not at all. In the year 1935, surprisingly, Jawaharlal Nehru wrote in his Glimpses of World History at page 720 and 507. These two pages are very important. He says, it is not easy to draw a line between Hindu nationalism and true nationalism. The two overlap as India is the only home for Hindus and they form a majority here. This is completely wrong. Hindus did not actually want to go out of the Bharatavarsha. It is their land which they worshipped. Why will they go to any other land? Even if they went, they would come back. They went as only traders. In fact, the educated and enlightened people were prevented from going over the seas because they wanted to maintain the sacredness of India. Then he says at page 507, it is very important because he directly endorses and accepts Vivekananda's concept of Hindu nationalism. A famous disciple of Vivekananda, Ramakrishna was Swami Vivekananda, who very eloquently and forcibly preached the gospel of nationalism. This was not in any way anti-Muslim or anti-anyone else. Nonetheless, Vivekananda's nationalism was Hindu nationalism and it had its roots in Hindu religion and culture. The entire misunderstanding came because of the misinterpretation of the word Hindu. Swami puts it beautifully in his Gems of Wisdom, which is the compilation of his quotes. I will refer to pages 268, 269. And it goes on for about several pages. And I will tell you what Bharat knew. The secret of peace lay in service and love towards all beings. The culture of this land. You see, the importance is the land. This land is not an accident. It is a creation of God. And that is why we don't want to occupy any other land because our land is special. That made us non-congruous. Bharat is the land where the triple sadhana of discipline, devotion and duty was first laid down. There it had the largest number of votaries through the ages. Throughout history, the culture of India struck the four goals of dharma, artha, kama, moksha. These are very, very important, great people. You can't see a Swami again, just as you can't see a Vivekananda. You can't even see a Gandhi in politics. You can never recall an Aurobindo. But all of them have spoken in the same thing, same vein, that this land is sacred. That this land is sacred is the very foundation of spiritual nationalism. And I don't want to quote more because Swami's book is always available with you. And how this misinterpretation took place, Radhakrishna explains it beautifully. He says, the meaning of the word Hindu was not creedal. That means it was not based on religion. It was not based on faith. It was not based on worship. It was based on territory. Anyone who lived in India was Hindu. And this whole thing changed later. And that is where the problem arose for India. And even Rajini Palme Dutt, who established the Communist Party in England, he wrote a book, India Today, in 1939. One of the objections at that time was whether India could have established a freedom movement if it had not learnt English. The Englishman said, we conquered you and we taught you English, through which only you rose up for freedom. Then Rajini Palme Dutt wrote in his India Today, you are a fool. our freedom movement would have germinated even in the exclusive Veda Padashalas run in different corners of the country. It is a communist saying it. No one had any difference on the spiritual foundation of India, and everything changed in 1940 when Pakistan, when Jinnah demanded Pakistan. Then everybody began going back on this concept. And everybody, and in the post-independence days, Hinduism became a creedal idea, not a geographical idea. And with the result, as when I was introduced, my tweet was quoted, whether it is Vande Mataram or Ramarajya or Hindu nationalism or Sanatana Dharma, became illegitimate in independent India. Even communal and harmful, all that drove the freedom movement and raised the spiritual nationalism of India, which is the identity of India, became abhorrent. In fact, people were afraid of talking about it. Fortunately, Hindu spiritual nationalism was saved by the Supreme Court. That is what I want to tell you, something which most Indians are not aware. A judgment was pronounced by the Supreme Court in the year 1996. I am going to quote this in extenso. This is very important for us to understand how the Supreme Court has restored the spiritual nationalist foundations of India, which politics has not yet accepted with unanimity. There is a rise of spiritual nationalism in India, but there is a huge contest against it also, but the Supreme Court has settled the issue that Indian nationalism is cultural and spiritual. I'm going to read it out to you. The Constitution bench judgment, you know, this judgment was in 1976. It is a very peculiar case of a Hindu marrying a Christian and having a Christian child, and whether that family constitutes a Hindu undivided family. See how beautifully the Supreme Court quotes the Encyclopedia Britannica to say that a Hindu family with the Christian members is a Hindu family. The Encyclopedia Britannica, they had to quote Encyclopedia Britannica to say this, because if you quote Aurobindo or Swami Vivekananda, it will be questioned. So quote the Encyclopedia Britannica. Hinduism constitutes a very complex but largely continuous whole, since it covers the whole of life. As a religion, Hinduism is an utterly diverse conglomerate of doctrines, cults, way of life. In principle, Hinduism incorporates all forms of belief and worship, without necessitating the selection or elimination of any. See how beautifully Sanatana Dharma is put. No way of worship needs to be excluded. The Hindu is inclined to revere the divine in every manifestation, whatever it may be, and is doctrinally tolerant. The most important thing is not individual tolerance, but doctrinal tolerance. If the doctrine is not tolerant, the individual tolerance is only exception. Doctrinal tolerance commands the individual to be tolerant. A Hindu may embrace a non-Hindu religion without ceasing to be a Hindu, because Hindu is cultural and spiritual. It has nothing to do with way of worship. On this basis, the Supreme Court decided in 1976, a constitution bench presided by R.S. Sattaria with M.H. Begg and all that, that religion is not the element of the idea of Hindu, and it is quoted by the Supreme Court in 1996 to say that this constitution bench decision say that no precise meaning can be ascribed to the word Hindu, Hindutva and Hinduism. And they quote Justice Barucha and M.M. Ismail Farooq in the Ismail case, Ahmadi. Hinduism is a tolerant faith. It is the tolerance that has enabled Islam, Christianity, Zoroastrianism, Judaism, Buddhism, Jainism, and Sikhism to find shelter upon this place. So Hinduism is not a religion competing with other religions. It is a religion which accepts other religions. This has been forgotten, suppressed to make politics workable in India. Supreme Court has rescued it. Supreme Court has rescued Hindu spiritualism. And it goes on to say that it cannot be doubted in view of the Constitution Bench decision that the word Hinduism or Hindutva are confined only to Hindu religious practices and unrelated to the culture and ethos of the people of India, depicting their way of life of the Indian people. With that, they settled that Hinduism or Hindutva is not sectarian. This is not being discoursed in India. I don't think even newspapers write about it. Intellectuals talk about it. Educational institutions even know about it. So, the travel of Indian spiritual nationalism from the Vedic days, from the Indus Valley days, from the days of the Puranas, revived and forgotten for 1,000 years, revived by Swami Vivekananda, Mahatma Gandhi, Aurobindo, including Jawaharlal Nehru, has been endorsed by the Supreme Court. So it is no more a theoretical idea, it's no more philosophical. It is the very foundation of India. And the Supreme Court decision in Ram Temple issue, which is a remarkable one, I don't think anyone would have cared to read the 1,000-odd page judgment. It's a fantastic summary of Indian civilization. And these are all kept aside. And very frivolous discourse takes place on the ground. So I think we need to understand more institutions like Satya Sai Institute of Learning, which is committed to the ideas, philosophy and ideas of Swami, to create awareness not only within and also outside, and the best guarantee that India can give to itself and to the world is to expound the concept of spiritual nationalism so that every nation considers itself sacred and it does not think the other nation is sacred for it to occupy, and that is where the problem arises. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Mesmerizing, to say the least. The way you put across your points of view, I thought, is as mesmerizing as how we lead our daily lives, mesmerized by Western thoughts. I hope this is an awakening call for all those who listened to your talk. A couple of quick takeaways that I can think of. It is so rich in content that I can never do justice trying to summarize this talk. Nevertheless, one thing that struck me clearly is the very clear demarcation between what is spiritual and cultural and what is religious. The minute the intelligentsia of the country understand this, we will get rid of a lot of hatred and communal ill feelings. So I think it's very, very important, a takeaway for all our listeners, which is about 1,500 people playing this back and 300 plus people watching this concurrently. That's about 2,000 people. And I would think a large part of them, a majority of them, the educated youth and the literati of the country, I think we must take home this point very seriously, that religion is very different from a spiritual and cultural understanding of a civilization. The second point that I really, really liked is that spiritualism has in it sacredness. And the minute we understand sacredness, we would probably keep far away from unsacred and unholy acts, which itself will lead to a depth and a clean approach to civilization. I don't know how many youngsters even know that our Bharatavarsha, as Sir said, was called Jambudipa. The name itself is probably very new. And then there is a story of the fruit, which we call the jambu, and then a lot of stories behind it. And I do hope that a lot of you are encouraged to go and read a lot about Indian history after this talk. There is this clear golden triangle between the culture, the land, and its people. And this triangle is, any one of the three legs is inseparable from the other two. So the minute we understand culture, land, and people, the connect, I think a lot of things will fall in perspective in Indian nationalism. If you were to ask me, how is this relevant to a webinar on English literature? I'm sure that some skeptics would have had this thought, and therefore I want to address this before I request, sir, whether we can take a few questions from the audience. How is this even relevant as part of English literature and a program of this kind? If we were open enough and if we noticed, Sir began from the earliest of Indian literature, and that is the Rig Veda and the Vedas, the Vedic literature. He went on to quote to us lines from the Puranas, the Agni Purana and the Brahmanda Purana and other things. And then he talked to us about Gandhiji, about Vivekananda before that, about Sri Aurobindo, about Pandit Nehru, about a lot of these, Dr. Radhakrishnan. And today, all the time we are talking about Hardy, Hugo, Arnold and Murdoch in our literature courses, which is perfectly okay. But do we give Dr. Radhakrishnan, Mahatma Gandhi and the others, Sri Aurobindo, the same importance that we give to the writers of English literature? That, I think, probably is one lacuna in our system, and I'm myself guilty of this as head of an English department. When Sir was talking about the beautiful description of the Kumbh Mela, and we mentioned the bangles and the bullock carts, I couldn't help but remember that there is in English literature somebody like Sarojini Naidu, who spoke beautifully in poetic lines about the bangle sellers or the Indian weavers or the Coromandel fishermen. So there is Indianness in so much of English literature around us also. So I would think this was a very, very befitting plenary session in this webinar, in my opinion, and I'm sure the audience agree with me. If you have a few minutes, sir, could we take a lot of questions from the audience, but a few questions if time permits, sir?
Yes, please.
Okay, sir. For a country, one of our participants, Mr. Ganesh Kumar, asks, for a country of 1.3 billion population, what are the two or three practical things that we must do as citizens, especially adults, to make them literate on spiritual nationalism and our great Indian culture?
You see, basically the responsibility is on people who command the intellectual heights of India. See, they have to reorient themselves, because the world is in a huge flux. In fact, I have been a keen observer of the world, and this is not the occasion to talk about the world, but I still mention liberal democracy in the West has been the catchword for the last 50, 60 years. You know what is the state of liberal democracy in the West? The Foreign Policy magazine brought out a study, Democracy and Disorder. And in that, it said the entire liberal democratic spectrum in the world is in turmoil. The Central and East European nations are willing to give up democracy and move over to autocracy. You know why? In liberal democracy, voting percentage, which was about 95% in 1960, is today around 60%. In America, not even majority people are voting. And more than that, in the Western countries, it is only the educated people, it is the rich people who are more on the upper side of the spectrum, they vote. The minorities, the uneducated people, that is less educated people, the people with lesser income do not vote. In India, it is the reverse. Minority votes 75%, 65% OBC, scheduled caste vote, 60% OBC vote. It is the forward caste and the educated people who vote less in India. That means the Indian democracy is wound at the bottom. So, the Foreign Policy magazine said, India is the only silver lining and even golden lining of democracy. Has any Indian newspaper written about it? First, we must cherish. It is the illiterate people of India who threw out the emergency in this country. When the literacy rate in India was less than 45%, and literacy rate in India where the Congress was defeated, the emergency rulers were defeated, were less than 40%, and women literacy was less than 22%. There is something in this country. So first, one thing I would like all the people, let us not talk about 1.3 billion people, according to me, they are all right. My appeal is to the English educated Indian. He has questions about India. He feels shy about India. 20 years back, he would not even call himself an Indian outside India. Today, it is a little more respectable to call oneself an Indian. First, exorcise your mind that English education is superior. English education is good. If you learn Japanese, it is good when you go to Japan. But the superiority complex which has been built by English education has been the reason for one of the steepest cultural declines in the world in India. So, being fortunate to know English, you be an English educated person like Vivekananda, like Gandhi, like Nehru, like Aurobindo. So, let us not think about 1.3 billion people. First, start with what I should do. Because the problem of India is a cerebral problem and not bottom of the spread problem. We are all at the cerebral levels of India. And if we correct the cerebral imbalance in India, much of the problems can be addressed because the people of India have always acted in the right spirit.
Answer, sir. Just about one or two more questions. How is it that spiritual nationalism failed to prevent divisiveness, untouchability of caste, oppressions, oppression of women, etc.?
You see, spiritual nationalism rests on the spiritual ecosystem. When the spiritual ecosystem was disturbed, and ecosystem is disturbed by a variety of reasons. There are internal faults as well as external faults. India was subjected to both. You know, when Fahim came to India, when you talk about modern criticism about India, you must also read about what happened. You know, there is a very recent study by the Brookings Institution about women. Is gender right and democracy and libertarianism adequate to protect women? This was the issue. These are all good. But protection for women or their safety is dependent on internal order and absence of external invasion. This is the recent finding. This is 2016 finding. Now I will go to what Fahim said when he came to India. He said India is the only country where women did not cover their face. It was covering the face was the universal feature in all nations. Not only that, they study, they read Till the 7th century, this was women's position. And later, our women began covering their face. What is the reason? Safety of the women were affected by external and internal reasons. So our entire concept of spiritual nationalism was in trouble. That's why I said there was a 1,000-year suspension. And Swami Vivekananda had to revive this talk. So the entire freedom movement was to revive the spirit of spiritual nationalism. So I am not saying a society is free of fault, but the society must have touchstones by which it will know what its faults are and correct it. And that is there in the Indian civilization in abundance.
Sir. Thank you, sir. We'll take just one more question if you permit.
Yes.
Do you think the new education policy, the NEP that everybody is talking about, will address our problem of lack of knowledge of our culture and heritage to some extent, or could it have been?
I don't think so. It will definitely address the rise of India in education, in research, in multidisciplinary capabilities. But the area which it has not touched is culture and spiritualism for political reasons. I think the government has done the right thing, because if you mix up the two, even this will be lost. So this requires an ecosystem adjustment, and it is coming. Maybe it will come 10 years later. You can never prepone the idea of an idea whose time has not come. So let us wait for the right time to talk about it. And I am not one of those who believes in government-led cultural revival. Swami Vivekananda did not have a government to support him. Gandhi did not have a government to support him. The way they... Swami, the day he worked for the cultural and spiritual revival of India, he was a government himself. So why should we always look to the government? India has always risen because of individual sages. It is the sages and not government which lifted India. So I am not government centric in my thinking. It may be because, you know, I have not been greatly enamored of government positions and all that. But I still believe government is at best a defense for India. And it cannot be the promoter of India. It is the people of India, the educational institutions, the intellectuals, the scholars, the spiritualists, who have to do this. For them, confidence about Indian culture, civilization, spiritualism is important. Modernity has greatly impacted on their mind, somehow to distance themselves from tradition. It's a very dangerous thing. Tradition is what keeps the link between the past and the present and gives hope for the future. And that, I think, only the families and spiritual leaders can show way.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much. I'm also personally very enamored by your idea of civilizational diplomacy, about which you spoke when the Chinese Prime Minister was hosted at Mahabalipuram last year. There was a fantastic article by you. And I was personally very enamored by this title that you gave, which said civilizational diplomacy, and a fantastic connection between the Buddha and the Buddhic trends in India. So what would you say is the way ahead if India had to take this up as a very serious endeavor? Civilizational diplomacy.
You see, actually the world... The time is ripe for India to expound its high values, because India has practiced it. All other countries have to disconnect from their past to talk about great things, because the amount of wrong things that have happened. You know, I'll just tell you one. I think you must ask all your people to look at a website known as Democide. The website name is Power Kills. That is the website. And the person who built it was R.J. Rammal.
Okay.
A professor of Hawaii University. He worked for 30 years to build this website. And he said in 2500 years, how many people have been killed in the world by human action? And he concluded that about 1.3 billion people at the maximum and 680 million people at the minimum have been killed by human action against humans. Until the 13th century, he cites only three instances of killings in India. One is the Ashoka Kalinga War. The second is thuggies, the criminals, organized criminals. Third is sati. And he says in sati and thuggi, killings were not even in tens of thousands. So the entire history of India for 1800 years, from 5500 BC to 1300 C, the killings were less than 200,000. So we have a history of tolerance, deliberative culture. This is what our Tarka Shastra does. Tarka Shastra says you argue at your differences. In fact, Amartya Sen spoke about argumentative Indian. That is one of the reasons for India avoiding violence. Because you have freedom of argument. You could argue against God. You could even today, there are debates going on in temples. Whether Rama was right in sending Sita to forest. I don't think any God could be questioned like this. Whether he was right in killing Vali. And we had such a bandwidth of perspective. We worshipped Sita because she obeyed her husband. We worshipped Meera because she defied her husband. We worship Rama because he obeyed his father. We worship Prahlada because he defied his father. We worship Lakshmana because he obeyed his brother. We accept Vibhishana because he defied his brother. I mean, please understand the bandwidth of perspectives we developed. So our civilization is probably the only one to say how complex cities can be managed, how conflicts can be managed. And this is the only non-conflicting civilization in the world, which is intrinsically accepting people with all their differences, with no normative imposition. Expound. It is the English educated people who can do this because they are the window of India to the world and of the world to India. And so because it is there's something to do with this whole thing is organized by the English department. I suppose that you will carry this forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much, sir. That was fantastic. A lot of thought put into this. And I'm sure we are carrying back home a lot of thoughts to think over and to put into action in terms of our reading and understanding. Before we bid bye to this session, two thoughts for all of us who are listening. If we are an English educated Indian, let us be like Swami Vivekananda or the Gandhi or the Nehru or the Aurobindo of Indian literature. And to all of us, let us consciously try and develop a sense of pride in our Indianness, because that's when there will be the real connect between the culture, the land and the people. This will bring greater harmony in our lives, in our society, and in our Rashtra. Thank you ever so much, sir, for sparing time and your very, very valuable thoughts with us. The Sri Sathya Sai Institute of Higher Learning is indeed indebted to you for accepting this offer and for delivering this lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you.